गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रृण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ओम्। डियर् फ्रेण्ड्स्, टुडे वी हेव् टु स्टार्ट् दि 12th चाप्टर् आफ् भगवद्गीता। इन् द लास्ट् क्लास् we completed the 11th chapter, the last shloka, that is matkarma krut mat paramo mat bhakta sangavarjitah nirvaira sarva bhuteshu yas samameti pandava. So this was the advice given by Lord Krishna to Arjuna at the end of that Vishwarupa sandarshana yoga. The 11th chapter was about Vishwarupa, the cosmic form, and then at the end of that Krishna advises Arjuna to do his worship, that is mat karma krut. Whatever action you do, that is karma yoga. He is suggesting a combination of karma yoga and bhakti in that shloka. Mat karma krut, mat paramaha. Mat paramaha means that there is nothing supreme, there is nothing greater than me. From your point of view, you should keep me as the highest goal. Me means not Krishna as such, but that mayavachinnam chaitanyam, that Ishvara swarupam as the highest goal. Then madbhaktaha, you be devoted to that, and then automatically when you are devoted to that, you will be sangavarjitaha. You will be detached. When you are attached to something, you are detached from all other things. So sangavarjitaha. Then when you are also, when you have disconnected yourself from the whole world, you will be a nirvairaha. So you will not have enmity with any being. So nirvairaha sarvabhuteshu. So that particular person, sa mam yeti pandava, he pandava, that sort of devotee, he reaches me. So that was the last, say, instruction or advice of Lord Krishna. So this 12th chapter called Bhakti Yoga, it is picking up from that. So basing on Krishna's advice, Arjuna again puts a question. So this is a very, very short chapter, a very short and sweet chapter having only about 20 shlokas. 20 shlokas maybe we may complete in, say, about 7-8 classes. But then it is a very important chapter in the sense that it means the students of Vedanta, we sometimes look down on say the bhakti, and even some teachers of Vedanta sometimes look down on bhakti. But then if we see in the overall context of say the human growth, bhakti is a very human growth means the spiritual growth, the spiritual process. So bhakti is a very, very important step. So this is where this chapter becomes very important. And as I said, this chapter is quite small. It has only about 20 verses. And then the first 12 verses, that is 1 to 12, they describe the two levels, that is sopadhika and nirupadhika. So these two words we are very well aware by this time. Nirupadhika means that Brahman which is not delimited by any upadhi. Upadhi means maya vachinna chaitanya, maya is an upadhi. Then sharira, this body, body mind complex are upadhis. So all these are upadhis. So whatever God form you visualize is an upadhi, because it is something which a human mind has visualized. So you imagine Lord Vishnu in Vaikuntham, you imagine Shiva in Kailasam, you imagine some other God in some other loka. All these things are parichinna. They are all, you have formulated those things, you have made those formulas and then set them up there, and then you are seeking some boons from them. But then this Supreme Brahman does not have any upadhi. So that Supreme Brahman which is defined or which is mentioned as, which is described as Satyam Jnanam Anantam, it does not have any upadhis. So that is that Nirupadhika. Nirupadhika Brahman we have seen. And we have also seen the Sopadhika Brahman in the last few chapters. So this chapter, shlokas 1 to 12, they talk about those two levels. And then Arjuna puts a question as to which is greater or which is a more advantageous strategy, which is a more useful strategy for the spiritual progress. So Arjuna's question starts like that, and then Krishna gives a detailed account of the comparative merits of these two paths. So that is 1 to 12. Then 13 to 20, it is all about the characteristics of a jnani. 13 to 20, that is till the end of the chapter, that is the characteristics of a jnani, a bhakta, a full-fledged bhakta. And this full-fledged bhakta is not different from jnani. What all qualities were described for jnani earlier in the second chapter and subsequently in some other, in the other chapters, all these are found in this man also. So which means that a perfect bhakta is also, he automatically becomes a jnani. We should also remember that in the second chapter itself, Shankaracharya was saying that whatever are the characteristics of a realized person, the same characteristics which are sedulously cultivated by the seeker also. Whatever characteristics a jnani has, the same qualities are sedulously cultivated by the seeker also. What is that line? That line is, sarvatra hi vedanta shastre krutarthasya lakshanani yani tanyeva sadhanani. Sarvatra hi vedanta shastre, throughout, everywhere in Vedanta, krutarthasya lakshanani yani. Krutartha means a person who has realized. That is, he has nothing further to achieve. He has already achieved what has to be achieved. So he is a krutartha. So that means he is a realized person. Krutarthasya lakshanani. What are the characteristics of that particular person? And tanyeva sadhanani. For the seeker, the same lakshanas, the same characteristics, they become the things to be emulated, to be sedulously cultivated by a careful seeker. So that is what we saw. So that way also we can see that jnani, what all qualities have been told for jnani, they are also told here. So you can see that this bhakta, a perfect bhakta, is almost on par with this jnani. But then this man, of course, he has to do the shravana manana nididhyasana. So that is, of course, that is one rider, that rider which we have to remember. So that is how this chapter ends. So we can straight away go into the chapter, because there is not much discussion. So in some chapters we have seen some long discussions, initial avatarika, etc., etc. But here, of course, there is not much discussion. We can straight away start off. Then let us read. Dvitiya prabhrutishu. Prabhrutishu adhyayeshu.
द्वितीय प्रभृतिषु अध्यायेषु
विभूत्यन्तेषु
विभूत्यन्तेषु
परमात्मनो ब्रह्मणः
परमात्मनो ब्रह्मणः
अक्षरस्य
अक्षरस्य
विध्वस्त सर्व विशेषणस्य
विध्वस्त सर्व विशेषणस्य
उपमा उपासनम् उक्तम्
उपासनम् उक्तम्.
सो द्वितीय प्रभृतिषु मीन्स् स्टार्टिङ्ग् फ्रम् दिस् सेकेण्ड् चाप्टर् From second chapter onwards, adhyayeshu, vibhutyanteshu, and ending up to this vibhuti adhyaya, vibhuti yoga. That is from second adhyaya to tenth adhyaya. Paramatmano brahmanaha aksharasya. Of that akshara brahma, here and there, that akshara brahma. Akshara brahma means that imperishable brahman. That imperishable brahman means the supreme brahman, which is defined as satyam jnanam anantam. So, from second chapter till about 10th chapter, here and there, aksharasya vidvasta sarva visheshanasya, one who is devoid of all these visheshanas. Visheshana means attributes, all types of description. All those descriptions are vidvasta, they are all demolished. Vidvasta literally means demolished. So, that means all visheshanas are negated, in a smaller ordinary meaning is negated. So all these visheshanas are negated in that supreme Brahman. For of such Brahman, upasanam muktam. So upasana is again not, it is not like saguna upasana. Saguna upasana, where upasana means tairadhara vatulya pratyaya santarihi, that is dwelling, having some stream of similar thoughts, undisturbed by dissimilar thoughts. So that is the description. Here, of course, upasana is not that. Upasana means Brahma Anusandhanam. So the meaning of Upasana in Nirguna Upasana is slightly, we have to understand it differently. Saguna Upasana we have to understand differently. Saguna Upasana means it is that Dhyanam, worship, and then all that, dwelling on the characteristics or merits of that God form. Whereas in Nirguna Upasana there is no worship as such. So Nirguna is something to be understood. So, Nirguna has to be understood. That understanding is the upasana there. Upasana means Nirguna Upasana. In the context of Nirguna Upasana, it is understanding. And that is achieved by Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi and all these statements. That is achieved by Shravana Manana Nididhyasana. So that is as a result of Shravana Manana Nididhyasana, whatever you achieve, is that upasana in the case, in the context of Nirguna Brahma. And in the context of Saguna Brahma, you have visualized certain things, you have visualized certain merits, and Saguna Brahma can be of different levels. Of course, here in the 11th chapter and also in the 12th chapter, we are talking about a Sopadhika Brahma at the highest level. That is Maya Vachinna Chaitanyam, and even above Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha is again from the context, from the point of view of Jiva, you call it Hiranyagarbha. And again, Maya Vachinna Chaitanyam Ishwaraha, from the point of overlording the whole thing, the same thing, the same Tattvam, you call it Hiranyagarbha, you call it Vishwara, you call it, what is this, Virat, isn't it? So, these levels we are calling. So, but then we are now at that highest level. Even Saguna worship can be different levels. So, Saguna worship can start from my village deity. From my village level, they say that we have got some Poli Ramma or some other Ramma. There is what is called a small stone in the middle of the village. It is so in that middle of the village, you are putting some Ammavaru. You call it Grama Devata. And then that is starting from that level, you call your Nagara Devata. Like Lanka has a Lankini as some, of course, she is not the goddess. She is the protector or she is some sort of guardian for that Lanka. So like that, every town can have a Nagara Devata. So now you have got our Telugu Thalli, now Telangana Thalli. So you have got, these are all our limited concepts of Saguna Brahma, isn't it? So our own idea of Saguna Brahma reveals our own maturity level also. Our own maturity level is revealed by the type of God you worship. So you tell me your God, I will tell you what you are, that is what people say. So if you are saying that your God is protecting you only, your God is hating others, your God is throwing stones on others, so that means you have projected your own ideas on the God. God does not do all those things. So anyway, so this now we are not at this level of Parichinna Sopadhika. We are at the highest level of, that is Maya Vachinna Chaitanyam Ishwaraha, one who is the control, one who is in charge of the whole, in charge in the sense, the Chaitanya from which the whole universe has emanated. So that level we are talking about. So Sarva Visheshanasya Upasana Muktam, that is Nirupadhika Brahma first. Then we are now coming to Ishvara. Sarva Yoga Ishwarya,
Sarva Yoga Ishwarya,
Sarva Jnana Shaktimat,
Sarva Jnana Shaktimat,
Sattvopadhehe Ishwarasya Tavacha,
Sattvopadhehe Ishwarasya Tavacha,
Upasanam Tatra Tatra Muktam.
Upasanam tatra tatra
uktam. Tatra tatra means here and there. Here and there this upasana has been told. Upasana means here we are talking about Saguna Upasana. Saguna Upasana of what? Sarva Yogaishwarya. Yoga. Yoga, we saw the meaning of yoga in this 10th chapter and 11th chapter. Yoga means ghatana. The ghatana means the capacity to materialize all this whole universe. Ghatana. Ghatana means to become. Ghatana is to effect something, to create the whole universe. So this ghatana means that srushti sthiti laya, that is the whole universe is caused, the whole universe is sustained, and then the whole universe, this resolution of this universe, all these things, they happen. Ghatana actually means happening, let us say, okay. Happening is a better word. Sarva yoga, so this happening of the whole universe, etc., Aishwarya, that is Samarthyam, that capability. Then Sarva Jnana Shaktimat. Now here of course, this is Jnana which is related to this creation, sustenance and resolution. This is Jnana we are referring to. That sort of Shaktimat. Shaktimat means one who is having that Shakti. Shaktimat Sattvopadhi. Sattvopadhi. This we have to see. Ishwara is different. So of course Maya is having all the three characteristics, Sattva, Rajas and Tamoguna. But Ishvara is not affected by this Rajoguna and Tamoguna. Ishvara is having only Sattvopadhi. Whereas when you visualize this Hiranyagarbha level, he is having that Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. So in that various God forms and all that. And then from that this Akasha, Vayu, etc., etc. The Upanishad has described like that. So here we are talking about the Shuddha Sattvopadhi. सो सत्वोपाधेः ईश्वरस्य तव च दैट मीन्स ईश्वर इज नॉट डिफरेंट फ्रॉम यू तव च मीन्स युवर्स when Arjuna is referring to Krishna as you, he is referring to him as that Maya Vachinam Chaitanyam. You are that Ishwara. From that point of view, he is speaking. Tavacha Upasanam Tatra Tatra Uktam. Then Vishwarupadhyayetu
Vishwarupadhyayetu
Aishwaram Adhyam Samasta Jagadatma Rupam Vishwarupam Tvadiyam Dashitam Upasanarthameva Tvaya
उपासनार्थमेव त्वया
तच्च दर्शयित्वा उक्तवानसि मत्कर्मकृत इत्यादि ओके विश्वरूपाध्यायेतु सो बट ऑन द अदर हैंड ही अर्लियर इन द लास्ट टू सेंटेंसेस ही टॉक्ड अबाउट सेकंड चैप्टर टू 10th चैप्टर सो विश्वरूपाध्यायेतु बट इन दिस विश्वरूपाध्याय दैट इज इमीडिएटली प्रीसीडिंग चैप्टर ऐश्वरम आद्यम कारणम Aishwaram. Aishwaram means that which is having a lordship over the whole universe. Adhyam. Adhyam means that which is the first one. Which means, which is the karana, which is the cause for everything. Adhyam. Adhyam means which is the cause, which forms the cause for the whole universe. Adhyam. Then not only that, samasta jagad atma rupam. For the whole universe, whatever is seen, it is the very essence. That is the pratyagatma, that is the inner self of everything which is there in this universe. Atmarupam, then Vishwarupam Tvadiyam Darshitam, that your Vishwarupa has been told. And for what? Upasanartham eva Tvaya, you have showed that thing for the sake of this Upasana. Then Tachya Darshayitva Vuktavanasi, having shown that, Tachya Darshayitva means having shown that, you had advised me, Mat Karma Krut Ityadi. So you had advised me, you do this Karma Yoga, the whole of Karma Yoga has to be dedicated to me. Karma Yoga has to be combined with this Bhakti too, because of course Karma Yoga has already got some component of Bhakti. We know that Karma Yoga means, say you are doing that Nishkama Karma, that is one. That is when you do perform Yajna, Yaga, etc., etc., you are doing it without Phalabhisandhi. That is the simplest understanding of Karma Yoga. But along with that, you are also doing your Nitya Karma, Naimitika Karma. In this Nitya Karma, you have got lot of what is this Panchamaha Yajnas you have got? You have got Atithi Puja, you have got Devata Puja, you have got Bhuta Yajna, Swadhyaya Yajna. So all these things are there. So Atithi Yajna means you are giving food to all the guests, whoever comes you are supposed to give food. You are supposed to give food to all these animals, all the beings. So like that, already this sort of helping others is also there. Then devata yajna. Devata yajna means devata archana, worshipping the gods, it is already there. So karma yoga is already having this component of yajna. Yajna means devatoddeshana dravya tyagaha, isn't it? Devatoddeshana, keeping some god in mind. You are doing some dravya tyaga, you are doing some charitable activity, you are giving away some money to various people. So that is yajna. So in that yajna, when you are doing with that view of nishkama karma, you are already worshipping God plus helping others. So this worship or bhakti is already built in to some extent in karma yoga. But then here, of course, we are supposed to give greater priority to this bhakti. Because bhakti is something which is rather unique. So if we want to understand bhakti, we have to read a little bit of bhakti literature also. Bhakti literature means, for example, we have to read Bhagavatam, Mahabhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam we have to read. We should also read, for example, Narada Bhakti Sutra. So you have got Brahma Sutra, or Yoga Sutra by Patanjali, or Sankhya Sutra by Kapila Maharshi. So you have got Bhakti Sutra by some people. Narada, the famous divine sage, he has written what is called Bhakti Sutra. There is another Rishi called Shandilya Muni. That Shandilya Muni has also written Shandilya Bhakti Sutra. So we have to read at least this Bhakti Sutras to some extent to understand what is this Bhakti. So in fact, I just happened to go through that Narada Bhakti Sutra. I just noted down some points. Which I can tell, because bhakti is something which we have to understand in the proper context. Bhakti, normally the students are teachers of Advaita Vedanta, we look down upon it as something which is an inferior thing. But then it is one of the surest strategies. It is one of the surest strategies for attainment, for the ultimate, attainment of jnana. So that is what we see in this bhakti. So if we just see this Narada Bhakti Sutra, in fact, that is something which we have to do it as a sort of supplementary reading for this chapter 12. When we are reading this chapter 12, you can just go to this Narada Bhakti Sutra, you can search on that Google, you will get Narada Bhakti Sutra, mostly with some commentary also you will get. You can just give a fast reading to that so that you can understand. If you can get hold of this Swami Akhandananda's commentary on that Bhakti, Narada Bhakti Sutra, it will be better. I happen to see that in Hindi. Those who know Hindi can see that Akhandananda Saraswati's commentary on that Narada Bhakti Sutra. That is again a very beautiful commentary. Then in Karnataka there is one Swamiji, Sachidanandendra Saraswati, a very very well known Swamiji who lived about 50 years ago. So that Swamiji is a very very eminent Swamiji, belonging to the class of that Madhusudana Saraswati, Anandagiri and people like that. And he has written several books. One book is a commentary on this, Narada Bhakti Sutra. So these books, which we can have a look at them, for understanding this bhakti in a better way. So this bhakti, let us see what it is. Bhakti, you see, has some advantages. What are those advantages? Normally, an important factor of bhakti, an important factor which we see in any society is religion. Religion means some bhakti also. There is some devotion to God. There is a lot of religious activity. So this bhakti has certain results at the social level. At the social level means the social cohesion, then keeping some peace and mutual love, affection, mutual help, etc., etc. Certain values are maintained by this, are affected or rather achieved by this bhakti. So that is at the social level. Then at the level of the seeker, what happens at the level of the seeker, we are interested in that here. So here, in the context of Atma Jnana, what happens in the case of a seeker and what is the psychology of this bhakti, we have to see. So this Karma Yoga, if you compare it with bhakti, so in Karma Yoga, what do we see? Karma Yoga shows your confidence or trust in yourself, isn't it? Karma Yoga basically, okay, I am doing this yajna, I am doing this, this is for my Chitta Shuddhi. So you are stopping at that Chitta Shuddhi level, isn't it? Whereas bhakti is something like anchoring on to a higher self. Anchoring, you know the anchoring, you know? Anchoring, that is when a ship has to be anchored somewhere, a boat has to be anchored somewhere, that is anchoring on to a higher thing so that you are safe. Or hooking on to something else. In order to, for example, some payload of some, satellite. So when that satellite goes away, all other modules break off, but this thing is taken up by that satellite, isn't it? So this is just an example. So you are either anchoring onto something or hooking onto something in order to go forward, in order to move forward. So somebody else is helping you. There is a helping hand. The basic point is there is a helping hand in bhakti yoga, whereas in karma yoga you are dependent on your own effort, you are dependent on your own ability, whereas in bhakti you are also hooking on to God, somebody who is pulling you up, somebody is udharana means ut plus harana, who is bringing you up, who is pulling you up, not pulling up in the bad sense, but bringing you up. So that is one thing. So bhakti is another thing which purifies the heart more easily than Nishkama Karma. Patanjali Yoga and Nishkama Karma, they also give some purity of thought. But bhakti purifies the heart more easily than Nishkama Karma. That is why we call it Bhakti Rasa. Bhakti is something which is a sort of emotion. It is an emotion which you feel. When you do Karma Yoga, you don't call it Karma Rasa. Whereas when you are doing bhakti, when you talk about Mirabai, when you talk about Surdas and what they did to their, the gods they loved, that is in both cases, of course, Krishna was the god. So Meera's love to Krishna, Surdas love for Krishna, so Tulasidas love for Rama. So this is again, this is bhakti rasa, where his heart, the devotee's heart melts. So bhakti is something where, say, a person is emotionally involved, and then say a person is very deeply emotionally involved. So that is one thing. Then, like nishkama karma, the bhakti should be a nishkama bhakti. Of course, nishkama, we see bhakti of both varieties. A person may be highly devoted. A person may be highly devoted, but every day praying for his own self. So that such cases we see quite often. Every day you pray, every day your whole world revolves around, or it is confined to your own son or your grandson. Your son has to get this, your son, daughter has to get this. So that is the type of bhakti which you have. So that is sakama bhakti. Of course, we need not condemn it totally. That is also good. That will produce its own result. But then in the context of a seeker, we are not talking about a sakama bhakti. We are talking about a nishkama bhakti, where you are understanding this, say, Ishvara Swarupa, which is revealed in this 11th chapter. You are thinking about that Vishwarupa level. You are thinking about that Vishwarupa level. And at that Vishwarupa level, you are devoting yourself. So that is the type of bhakti, which is that nishkama bhakti. And then this nishkama bhakti, gives all virtues, in the sense that, like the last para said, nirva badbhaktaha sangavarjitaha. When you are hooked on to that, the higher self, you naturally get detached from all other things. And then naturally you will not hate anybody. Naturally you will love everything else, because all around, whatever you see all around you, you love that. You don't hate anybody. So this love becomes an automatic quality of yours. Loving all humanity becomes an automatic quality of a great devotee. Like Prahlada. Prahlada is again a very great example. The Hiranyakashipu was sending all elephants and all those things. Elephant to trample this boy. But then elephant also would not trample that boy, because Prahlada was one who was not hating anything. So when you don't hate anything, other animals also, all people, they love you also. When you love everybody, they also love you. That is what we saw only yesterday in, what is that, Keno Upanishad. Sarvani Bhutani, Abhi Sarvani Bhutani Samvayan Shanti. So, when this man loves the whole universe loves him. The whole universe respects him as though this, and they also worship him like that God. So, that is what Keno Upanishad says. So, like that, this is another, bhakti is a tool which, gives these virtues more easily than other strategies like karma yoga, or atma sanyama yoga, patanjali yoga, etc., etc. Then we also saw earlier in one shloka, patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktiya prayachati. You just give some leaf, you just give some flower, you just give a fruit, you just give, offer some water, the Lord is quite happy. He does not require any elaborate material. Whereas for the performance of a yajna or some other thing, you require elaborate material. So even a very, very ordinary man, a very, very lowly person, a very poor person, like Kuchela also, he can be a very great devotee. There is absolutely no class distinction. You need not have 1,000 rupee ticket or 2,000 rupees ticket. So even without anything, with 1 rupee, you can go and have darshan. So this is the strategy of bhakti. Then bhakti does not need any other prerequisites like shama, dama, etc., etc. So, for example, all other things, they require shama, dama. For example, when you compare it with jnana, the path of jnana, jnanam, for example, this is a point by Swami Akhandananda Saraswati. He says, jnanam is like a VIP. How? Suppose somebody, some president comes, a president visits, and then there is so much of elaborate arrangements. The police people make a lot of elaborate arrangements. There is so much of checking here and there. Some anti-sabotage checks are there. Some other squad will come, some dog squad will come, and all those checks are there. The whole area is sanitized. So the whole area is carefully kept for this gentleman's safety. So only then that that President of India comes. So this jnanam, or the knowledge, or Brahma jnanam, is something like that VIP. It can come only when your mind is very, very pure. You should have achieved all those shama, dama, all that shamadhi, shatka, sampatti, and then chitta shuddhi, all those things should be there. That is all a prerequisite for that jnanam to come, isn't it? But for the sake of God, all that is not required. God, if you just show your love, He will come. You just, it is something like our, say, courts. You just post a letter, we will take it up. So that is what post, so our courts also say. So like that, God is somebody, the moment you call, He will come. So that is why bhakti does not need any other prerequisites like this shama, dama and all these things. And then bhakti also leads to this shama, dama, vairagya. Bhakti slowly leads to shama, shama, dama, vairagya, because your whole attention is on that God only. And then automatically you will achieve all other virtues like shama, dama, etc. Jnanam may come and occupy like a VIP. It comes and occupies the throne where everything is kept ready. But bhakti is not like that. Bhakti is there in your mind. And then when bhakti is there, automatically it pulls from the other side. Then bhakti is also compared to, say, the way how bhakti operates. This is again, this is an example given by this Akhandananda Saraswati. He quotes one, point. He says, Bhikshu Pada Prasarana Nyaya. Somebody was staying in a small hut, a very, very small hut. And then some saint came. And then saint wanted some space. So, okay, this saint came and then some sort of sadhu, let us say. The sadhu came. So, this householder gave him some space. So, that man was just having adequate space to sit. But then slowly he started stretching his legs, stretching his hands. And then he slowly occupied the whole small little cottage. So like that, God enters slowly and then slowly occupies the whole, mind. When you invite God into your mind, He comes slowly and then drives away all other things and He occupies your house. Bhikshu Pada Prasarana Nyayam. And if you want to use a modern example, Arab and the camel. Arab and the camel is another story which we know. The camel slowly enters and drives away the Arab, isn't it? So, that Arab and the camel story you must have heard. So like that. But here of course the example, our Samskrita Nyaya is Bhikshu Pada Prasarana Nyaya. So that sannyasi comes, that sadhu comes and then slowly occupies the whole cottage. So likewise, God also slowly enters the heart and drives away all other unwanted things. So that is another good things, which another good comparison between bhakti and other things. Then, in Karma Yoga, again comparing with Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga, there are so many rules. Rules means you have to recite some mantras. You require so many pujaris to come. So that man has to recite the mantras in a very, very perfect way. So all these udatta, anudatta, swaras. So there should not be any defect in those swaras. If there is any defect in those swaras, again it will it will have some adverse effect on the fellow. So all these problems will be there. But then in bhakti, there are no rules. Love knows no rules. So like that, there are no rules in this bhakti, channel. Bhakti does not require all these things like this asana, pranayama, etc., etc. And all those things, they are not there. So there is no physical strain. There is no financial strain. What all you have to have is just invite that person very, very honestly into your mind. So that is another comparison. Then another comparison which is given by Swamiji is, mind is something like a wax. Mind is something like a wax. It melts when there is an emotion in the mind. Normally, whenever you are emotionally excited, whether it is for the right reason or wrong reason, your heart melts. You see, you just find some change in the heart, in the very, very system of the functioning of the heart changes whenever there is an excess joy, or whenever you are having some other feeling, some feeling of sorrow, the heart melts. So here, bhakti is an emotion. It is a positive emotion, which melts the mind, and then it is easy. It is easy to remove all these bad things from the mind and then imprint some good things into the mind. So when the mind is melting like this wax, it is easy to remove all these bad samskaras and imprint new samskaras. This is another point which you have to note. It is something like a seal which can be printed on a molten wax. Suppose there is a molten wax. So on that molten wax, you can print seal more easily. So like Shakespeare says somewhere, women's waxen hearts. Women's hearts are supposed to be waxen. It is something, it melts like a wax. So, and then in those mold, in those women's waxen hearts, handsome people, they print their, say, forms. So, that is what Shakespeare says somewhere. So, it is like that. So, when this bhakti melts your heart, it is easier to remove all the dross. Dross means D-R-O-S-S, dross, all unwanted material. And then imprint whatever you want, whatever positive samskaras you want. So, it is something like that. So, bhakti is, another point is, bhakti is not to please Ishvara, but to purify ourselves. It is not something for pleasing that man, but basically, when you are emotionally involved, you are purifying yourself. And then, bhakti is also compared to a sort of relationship between lovers. The bhakta or a devotee is compared to the lady love. The god is compared to be the lover. So, when you are trying to go, say for example, karma yoga. A karma yoga, you have to slog and then you have to reach God, isn't it? So, suppose this lady love, you have to cross the river and go. A karma yogi has to cross the river and go. He has to jolly well make all effort to cross the river and go. And in the case of bhakti, it is not like that. You try to cross the river, the lover comes and picks you up. The lover comes and picks you up halfway through and then takes you there. So, it is compared to that. So, it is called Prema Rupa. Narada Bhakti Sutra, if you see, this is Satu Asmin Parama Prema Rupa Amrita Swarupa. Even when you are in the process of bhakti, it gives you a lot of, say, bliss. That happiness is there in bhakti. That happiness or bliss may not be there in Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga, you may have some satisfaction, but then that bliss is not there. But in bhakti, even when you are practicing, that particular bliss is there. This is that, say, Narada Bhakti Sutra, Parama Prema Rupa, Amrita Swarupa. This is that, say, Bhakti Sutra 3. So, this eternal, this Prema is our, say, attitude to the God. Prema, love, pure love is our attitude to the God. It is the external appearance. But internally, the essence of that is Amrutam, Amrita Swarupa. Rupa and Swarupa. These are two words. Asmin Parama Prema Rupa. Prema is the Rupam. Amrita Swarupa. Amrutam is the Swarupa. So that is what, we see some of the points which I just noted down from, this Narada Bhakti Sutras. So this Narada Bhakti Sutra, I advise you to read. So then, let us come back to this thing. Because this by way of introduction, I wanted to tell you the basic, the importance of bhakti. Because bhakti is something which we should not deride. It is a very, very important factor. In fact, moksha sadhana samagriyam bhakti reva gariyasi. That is what Shankaracharya also says in Viveka Chudamani. Moksha sadhana samagriyam bhakti reva gariyasi. Of course, in the very second line he says, swasvarupa anusandhanam bhakti rityabhidhiyate. So, of all the samagri, of all the material which is available for the human being to attain that moksha, bhakti is the greatest. And how do you define bhakti? Swasvarupanusandhanam bhaktihi ityabhidhiyate. That is, knowing your own self, swarupa anusandhanam, that atma anusandhanam or brahma anusandhanam. Brahma is the same as atman, that sort of anusandhanam. That application, anusandhana actually means application. Application of that idea to you. Continuous application of that idea is called anusandhanam. So, that sort of anusandhanam is bhakti at that higher level. So, that is what we saw, that nirgunopasana. Sagunopasana, we are now talking about this Arjuna's predicament. We are talking about our predicament where we are following this strategy of bhakti in order to cleanse all the dirt from the minds and then achieve this nirvaira sthiti where you have love towards all the beings, and then from there you are by the grace that you deserve that divine grace, and the divine grace falls, and then you achieve that the process of shravana marana vidhyasana, your mind is totally fit, and then you will automatically, you are fit in, you are eligible to understand it straight away. So, this is the background. Vishwarupadhyayetu adarshayitva bhuktavanasi matkarma krut ityadi. Let us read. अतः अहम् अनयोः उभयोः पक्षयोः विशिष्टतर बुभुत्सया त्वां पृच्छामि इति. सो अनयोः उभयोः पक्षयोः मीन्स् बिट्वीन् दीस् टू पार्ट्स्. वाट् पार्ट्स्? निर्गुणापात् अण्ड् सगुणापात्. विशिष्टतर बुभुत्सया. बुभुत्सा मीन्स् डिज़ैर् टु नो. विशिष्टतर बुभुत्सा मीन्स् द डिज़ैर् टु नो विच् ईस् ग्रेटर्. विशिष्टतर, विशिष्टम् इस् विच् इस् से मोर् से इम्पार्टेण्ट्. विशिष्टतर बुभुत्सय त्वां पृच्छामि. ऐ एम् आस्किङ्ग् यू. अर्जुन उवाच. अर्जुन उवाच एवं सततयुक्ताये भक्तास्त्वां पर्युपासते ये चाप्यक्षरमव्यक्तम् तेषां के योगवित्तमाः. ओके. एवं सततयुक्ता ये. एवम्, एवं मीन्स् इन् दिस् मेनर्. इन् वाट् मेनर्? दट् ईस् वाट् वास् रेफर्ड् टु इन् दट् लास्ट् श्लोक आफ् 11th अध्याय. लास्ट् श्लोक दट् ईस् 11-55. दट् श्लोक वट् डस् इट् से? द सेम् वट् वी रेड् अलियर्. मत्कर्म कृत् मत्परमः मद्याजि सङ्गवर्जितः एट्से मद्भक्तः सङ्गवर्जितः एट्सेट्रा एट्सेट्रा. सो इन् दट् मेनर्, एवं मीन्स् इन् दट् मेनर् सततयुक्ताः. आल्वेस् युक्त. युक्त मीन्स् वन् हू इस् वेरि स्टेड् फास्ट्. Yoked. Yukta means yoked. One who is steadfast in your devotion. Steadfast, one who is not swerving from your devotion. One who is so totally dedicated to you. Evam satata yuktaha. Ye bhaktaha tvam paryupasate. Those bhaktas. Ye bhaktaha means those devotees who worship you. Tvam, you, paryupasate. Paryupasate means pari plus upasate. Those people who worship you. That is one category. That is what category is that? That is the ordinary category. Manda, Madhyama category of devotees. Then we have also seen the other type of jnanis, the people who are capable of contemplation. So that is referred to in the next line. That is Uttamadhikari, what we call. Uttamadhikari, the top level student who is capable of say understanding the meaning of Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi, etc. etc. So that is the second line. ये च अपि अक्षरम् अव्यक्तम्. ये च अपि अक्षरम् अव्यक्तम्. ये च एण्ड् दोस् हू. ये च दोस् हू अक्षरम् अव्यक्तम्. अक्षरम् अव्यक्तम् उपासते इस् दि वर्ड् हियर्. उपासते इस् दि वर्ब्. अक्षरम् उपासते. अक्षरम् अव्यक्तम्. अक्षरम् इस् दट् इम्पेरिशबल् ब्रह्मन्. अव्यक्तम् दट् अन्मेनिफेस्ट्. अन्मेनिफेस्ट् हियर् वी शुड् नाट् टेक् माया. Unmanifest, depending on the context, we refer to either Maya or we refer to the Supreme Brahman. In this context, we are referring to the Supreme Brahman. So, yecha aksharam avyaktam upasate, tesham means between those two, between these two groups. There is one group which is, say, doing upasana of this Ishvara. There is another group which is knowing about that Supreme Brahman, aksharam Brahma. तेषां के योगवित्तमाः. हू आर् द पीपल् हू नो योग वेल्. हू आर् द पीपल् हू यू हू नो योग बेटर् आर् बेस्ट् रादर् योगवित्तम. तर तम, यु नो दोस् वर्ड्स्. तर मीन्स् कम्पेरिटिव् डिग्रि. तम मीन्स् सुपर्लेटिव् डिग्रि. योगवित्, योगवित्तरः, योगवित्तमः. योगवित् मीन्स् वन् हू नोस् दट् योग. योगवित्तरः नोस् इट् बेटर्. तर बेटर्, बहुतर बेटर्. Then best, that is who are the people who know best. Yoga with tamaha. Tara and tama. Tama is superlative. So who are those people who know yoga best? And what is this, what is the meaning of this yoga here? Yoga means a strategy for moksha. Mokshopayaha. Yoga, we should not say confuse with Patanjali yoga or karma yoga or some other yoga. The problem with Gita is in every context, you have to carefully see the letters. You have to carefully use the words. See, I mean, understand the words. Otherwise, we may have some vague meaning without knowing what exactly that word means at that particular place. Yesha, tesham, ke yogavittamaha. Who are the people who know the strategy best? Strategy means strategy for attaining moksha. Strategy for attaining jnana. Moksha means moksha is only possible by jnana. So, which is better? So, that is the question. एवमिति अतीतानंतर श्लोकेन उक्तमर्थं परामृशति मत्कर्मकृत् इत्यादिना ओके एवमिति दट वर्ड एवं रेफर्स टू अतीतानंतर श्लोक अतीत अनंतर दट इज इमीडिएटली प्रिसीडिंग अतीतानंतर मीन्स इमीडिएटली प्रिसीडिंग वर्स व्हाट इज दट इमीडिएटली प्रिसीडिंग वर्स द लास्ट वर्स ऑफ द 11th चैप्टर देन श्लोकेन उक्तमर्थं परामृशति परामृशति मीन्स इट रेफर्स परामर्श परामर्श मीन्स स्पीकिंग टू समबडी इज़न्ट इट परामृशति दट ईज इट रेफर्स टू दट पर्टिक्युलर श्लोक मत्कर्मकृत् इत्यादिना सो देर वाट वॉज एडवोकेटेड देर इट वॉज इन द कर्मयोग वॉज एडवोकेटेड देर भक्ति वॉज ऑल्सो एडवोकेटेड देर सो दट इज इट लेट अस रीड एवं सततयुक्ता नैरंतर्येण भगवत्कर्मादौ यथोक्ते अर्थे समाहिताः अर्थे समाहिताः सन्तः प्रवृत्ता इत्यर्थः ये भक्ताः अनन्यशरणाः सन्तः त्वां यथादर्शितं विश्वरूपं पर्युपासते ध्यायन्ति ओके सो एवं इन दिस मैनर सतत युक्ताः ही इज एक्सप्लेनिंग द वर्ड सतत युक्ता सततम मीन्स नैरंतर्येण नैरंतर्य मीन्स विदाउट लीविंग एनी गैप अंतरम मीन्स गैप निरंतरम मीन्स नो गैप नैरंतर्य इज दट स्टेट वेर यू लीव नो गैप अट ऑल सो नैरंतर्येण सो इन दट मैनर सो यू आर इन्वॉल्व इन दट स्टेट ऑफ ब्रह्मन से डिवोशन not Brahma consciousness, you are in that state of Brahma devotion. Nairantaryena, Bhagavat karma adau, Bhagavat karma means, whatever karma is entrusted to you, whatever is enjoined on you, you are doing it with Ishwararpana buddhi. In addition to that, you are increasing the component of bhakti. In karma yoga, component of bhakti may be small. In bhakti, your regular karma may be there, but then that becomes secondary. Your regular karma becomes secondary, bhakti becomes primary. So that is one basic thing, because karma yoga, it does not totally exclude bhakti. Karma yoga is having some element of bhakti. But here bhakti yoga, that bhakti predominates and karma yoga recedes, it becomes subsidiary or secondary. Bhagavat karma adau, yathokte arthe samahitaha. Yathokte arthe means yathokta, that which has been told earlier. अर्थे समाहिता संतः समाहिताः दोस हु हैव फिक्स्ड देयर माइंड ऑन दैट समाधि वो नो समाधि द वर्ड समाहिता इज फ्रॉम द सेम वर्ड समाधि समाहिता संतः प्रवृत्ताः देन ये भक्ताः अनन्य शरणाः संतः दिस भक्ता अनन्य शरणाः वी सॉ दिस वर्ड अनन्य शरण मीन्स there is no other refuge other than you. This ananya sharana also is again a word which was used in the 11th chapter. At the end of the 11th chapter, the word ananya sharana was used. Ananya sharana, na anyaha sharanam yasya, sa ananya sharana. That is, there is no other refuge other than this. So that refuge is the supreme Ishvara only is the refuge. There is no other refuge. So that is the meaning. So that is, he is dedicated to this Ishvara, to Ishvara only. Ananya Saranas Santaha, Thvam Yathadarshitam Vishwarupam, that is, that Vishwarupa, these people are devoted to that Vishwarupa only, Pariyupasate Dhyayanti. You are referring to this category of people who have fixed their attention, their whole devotion on this Vishwarupa. So that is this line. Then we are coming to the next category, that is the jnanis. Yecha anye api tyakta sarvaishanaha sanyasta sarvakarmanaha yatha visheshitam brahma aksharam nirasta sarvopadhitvat avyaktam karana gocharam we'll stop here. Yecha anye, the others, anye means others, those others, who are they? Tyakta sarvaishanaha, all these yeshana, we know this dareshana, putreshana, vitneshana, those, yeshana trayam, we know. So those all those yeshanas, all those desires, they have discarded all those desires. Then sanyasta sarvakarmanaha, they have also renounced all action, all so such people. Then yatha visheshitam brahma, that is the Brahman which has been described as above, as earlier, yatha visheshitam, that is akshara para brahma, aksharam, avyaktam. So which the Brahman which has been described in such words as aksharam, avyaktam, satyam, jnanam, anantam, akhandam, avikari, all those words are there, isn't it? Asthulam, ananu, asvalpam, adhirgam, adhirgam, all these things are there. Not this, not this, not this. So in that manner, nirasta sarvopadhitvat, all these upadhis have been discarded. Nirasta, nirasta means discarded. Nirasta sarvopadhitvat aksharam. Because all these upadhis have been discarded. So that is why it is called aksharam. When you have an upadhi only, it is you are sharam. When you have an upadhi, that upadhi dharma is to decay, isn't it? Upadhi, body mind complex is an upadhi. This maya itself is an upadhi. That maya itself is something which disappears also. So this maya vachana chaitanyam also is a sort of upadhi. Maya, so that upadhi again disappears, isn't it? So here nirasta sarvopadhitvat aksharam, because there is no say upadhi, all the upadhis have been, all the delimiting factors have been discarded, so that is why it is called aksharam. Then avyaktam, the meaning of avyaktam is, that is akarana gocharam. Karanam means indriyam, sense organ. Akarana gocharam, it is beyond the sense organs, beyond the mind, beyond the comprehension. So that is the meaning. Then yadhi loke karana gocharam,
yadhi loke karana gocharam,
tad vyaktam uchyate,
tad vyaktam uchyate,
anjehe dhatoho,
anjehe dhatoho,
tat karmakatvat,
tat karmakatvat,
idam tu aksharam tad viparitam,
idam tu aksharam tad viparitam,
shishtaishya uchyamanaihi visheshanaihi,
shishtaishya uchyamanaihi visheshanaihi,
visishtam tad,
visishtam tad,
yecha api paryupasate,
yecha api paryupasate.
Okay, we'll stop here. The sentence is not yet completed. So, yadhi loke karana gocharam. Whatever is comprehensible by the indriyas. Karana gocharam means that which can be comprehended by the indriyas, by the senses. That is called vyaktam. Vyaktam, actually Shankaracharya is going to explain the grammatical point also here. Not grammar, the etymological meaning of the word vyaktam. Vyaktam is V plus akta, is vyakta, isn't it? The word akta comes from a dhatu called anji, anju dhatu. Anju dhatu plus, you know, the kta form, kta, kta pratyaya. Bhunj plus kta becomes bhokta. Gam plus kta becomes gata, isn't it? Gam plus gata, gata means that which has gone. Bhokta, that which has been eaten. Supta, that is slept. So something like that kta pratyaya indicates something which is already happened, isn't it? So this anj plus kta becomes akta, that is getting manifested, that is we use the word prakata, prakati bhavati. Prakata means it becomes manifest. So that is the meaning of anj dhatu. Anj dhatu, the very meaning is to get manifested. So V plus anj plus kta becomes vyakta. So that is what Shankaracharya is saying. Yadhi karana gocharam tad vyakta muchyate, anjehe dhatoho tat karma katvat. This anj dhatu does that job. Tat karma katvat means the anj dhatu does that karma. Does that karma means that is getting manifested. Tat karma katvat, that dhatu, anj dhatu, it actually means getting manifested. So that is why it is called vyaktam. Whatever is known to the indriyas is called vyaktam. Then idam tu aksharam tadviparitam. This particular thing which we are now referring to is that aksharam which is totally different from that. Then shishtaischa uchyamanaihi visheshanaihi. Shishtaihi means by all learned people, by all these realized people, not learned, realized, you can note down. Jnani bhihi. Shishtaihi means jnani bhihi. What does your book say? Your book says Shishtai or any other word?
Shishtaischa.
Okay, fine. Shishtai. My book also says Shishtai. Shishtaischa उच्यमानैः विशेषणैः, ज्ञानिभिः उच्यमानैः विशेषणैः, ऑल दिस वाइज पीपल, ऑल द से रियलाइज्ड पर्सन्स, दे गिव दिस विशेषणास एंड देन तद् ये चापि पर्युपासते. सो दोस् हू डू उपासना, दट ईज अनुसंधानम, दट ईज एप्लीकेशन, एप्लीकेशन ऑफ दोस् वर्ड्स लाइक तत्वमसि, अहम् ब्रह्मास्मि, एट्सेट्रा एट्सेट्रा. सो दट ईज वाट ईज कॉल्ड उपासना इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ ज्ञानीस. ज्ञानीस उपासना मीन्स अनुसंधानम, अनुसंधानम मीन्स एप्लीकेशन. सो देन तेषां उभयेषां मध्ये,
तेषां उभयेषां मध्ये
के योगवित्तमाः, के अतिशयेन योगविदः इत्यर्थः. ओके, तेषां उभयेषां मध्ये, बिट्वीन दीज टू ग्रुप्स, हू आर द पीपल हू हैव, हू आर फॉलोइंग द बेटर स्ट्रैटेजी. योगवित्तमः, ऐ एक्सप्लेन दट वर्ड, दट वर्ड इज इन द सुपरलेटिव. अतिशयेन योगविदः, अतिशयेन मीन्स ऑफ द हाईएस्ट ऑर्डर, योगविदः ऑफ द हाईएस्ट ऑर्डर. सो देर इज नथिंग बियॉन्ड दैट. सो दट इज इट, हू विच इज द हाईएस्ट पाथ, विच इज द मोस्ट श्योर, विच इज द श्योरेस्ट पाथ. सो दट इज द मीनिंग. श्री भगवान उवाच, ये तो अक्षरोपासक, नॉट द श्लोक ऑफ कोर्स, ये तो अक्षरोपासकाः, सम्यग्दर्शिनो निवृत्तैषणाः, इज देर एनीथिंग एल्स इन युवर बुक, निवृत्तैषणाः, ते तावत् तिष्ठन्तु, तान् प्रति यद् वक्तव्यम् तद् उपरिष्टाद् वक्ष्यामः, येतु इतरे, इज अ स्माल अवतारिका. सो शंकराचार्य इज सेइंग, येतु अक्षरोपासकाः. सो यू फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल जस्ट वेट फॉर, से दिस, लेट द ज्ञानीज वेट फॉर सम टाइम, आई विल फर्स्ट टेल अबाउट द भक्तास. सो दट इज वाट इज द मीनिंग हियर. येतु अक्षरोपासकाः सम्यक् दर्शिनः, दोस् उपासक ऑफ अक्षर ब्रह्म, दोस् पीपल हू आर निवृत्त, सम्यक् दर्शिनः, सम्यक् दर्शि मीन्स दोस् हू हैव द राइट अंडरस्टैंडिंग, पीपल हू हैव दट राइट अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ ब्रह्मन एंड दोस् हू हैव डिस्कार्डेड दिस ऐषणास एट्सेट्रा एट्सेट्रा, ते तावत् तिष्ठन्तु, लेट देम वेट फॉर सम टाइम, ते तावत् लेट देम वेट फॉर सम टाइम, तान् प्रति यद् वक्तव्यम, वाट एवर आई हैव टू से अबाउट देम आई विल टेल लेटर, तान् प्रति यद् वक्तव्यं तद् उपरिष्टाद् वक्ष्यामः, उपरिष्टाद् मीन्स लेटर, उपरिष्टाद् वक्ष्यामः, ऐ विल् टेल् लेटर्. वक्ष्यामः आफ् कोर्स् कृष्णा ईज् यूसिङ्ग् इन् द प्लूरल्, द रायल् वी रादर्, दट् वक्ष्यामः मीन्स् वी विल् से, वी विल् एक्स्प्लेन् लेटर् अबौट् दोस् पीपल्, लेट् दम् वेट् फार् सम् टैम्, बट् देन् लेट् मी टेल् अबौट् दीस् भक्तास् फस्ट्. Suppose you are having somebody who is highly devoted to you, who is bringing tea right from morning, who is doing your service right from morning till night. So you want to show love to that man. So God's attitude seems to be like that. So first of all, you love somebody who is actually serving you from morning till evening, isn't it? So let us read this shloka. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. मयि आवेश्य मनो ये माम् नित्ययुक्ता उपासते श्रद्धया परयोपेताः ते मे युक्ततमा मताः. सो दोस् पीपल हू हैव फिक्स्ड देयर डिवोशन इन मी, मयि आवेश्य मनः, मयि इन मी, Manaha Avesya, having fixed their mind in me. Avesha, we know the word Avesha, Avishati. Avesha means something like a possessed person. You are possessed by that. So here, of course, he is not possessing God. He is fixing his mind in that God. So Manaha Mayi Avesya, that mind has been fixed in that. Then Ye Maam, those who, me, नित्ययुक्ताः उपासते, उपासते मीन्स दोस् हू वर्शिप मी, नित्ययुक्ताः, ऑलवेज स्टेडफास्ट इन देयर डिवोशन, नित्ययुक्ताः, ऑलवेज स्टेडफास्ट, फर्म, अनस्वर्विंग इन देयर डिवोशन. देन श्रद्धया परया उपेताः, परया श्रद्धया, श्रद्धा मीन्स डिवोशन, दट कमिटमेंट, श्रद्धया परया, परा मीन्स सुप्रीम, दिस परा वर्ड इज एडजेक्टिव फॉर श्रद्धा, पराया श्रद्धया, सुप्रीम डिवोशन, विद दट सुप्रीम सेंस ऑफ डिवोशन, उपेताः, उपेताः मीन्स दोस् हू आर हैविंग दट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक, उपेताः, ते मे युक्ततमा मताः. दोस् पीपल दे आर् युक्ततमाः. ई लव देम मोस्ट. युक्ततमः मीन्स् इन् मै व्यू. मताः मीन्स् दे आर् डीम्ड, दे आर् कन्सिडर्ड् बै मी. मत वर्ड् वी हव् सीन् इन् केनोपनिषत् आल्सो. मन धातु मतं मीन्स् with that which is deemed, that which is say accepted or agreed. So in that sense, they may yukta tamaha mataha, I consider them as yukta tamaha, those who are very well yoked with this jnana, yoked not jnana, with this bhakti yoga. So in that sense, but here of course we have to again see the meaning of yukta. We will see that in the next class, because this yukta does not refer to jnana yoga, it only refers to this bhakti. Yukta tamaha, they are the people who are supposed to be very perfect. So in that sense, perfect means they are very perfect devotees. So I love them most. So that is the meaning. So we'll see in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.